Feeling. Good chat about Zero and Q tonight. It's something that I came across a couple years ago, having to figure out some sort of interaction between a couple of different services that we were working with at the time. Name's Roger Sims, not very active, but just in case anybody wants to look me up afterwards, all these people on Twitter. Also, anybody who's on Northern Ireland Slack channel, Rog, RJ, feel free to make a benefit. I have to apologise, this talk I started whenever I agreed to do it, I don't know, 2-3 months back, and then started a new job, and I've had very little time to look over it again, so I'll probably be a little bit patchy in places, but we'll get through. Feel free to interrupt at any time, just ask questions. Anyway, Qs, why bother with them? Anybody here using any Q of any description? Just going to give a quick overview first of Qs and where we get to. So, a couple of hands, what sort of things are people using?
Chrome jobs and databases.
Yay! yourself?
RabbitMQ.
RabbitMQ, okay, yeah, also. Definitely a lot better. but again, have a bit of a chat about that in the first place. So, for those who don't use Qs at all, they're really handy for things like long-running tasks, maybe doing some routine updates in the background, pretty much anything. We're PHP here tonight, so pretty much not everything, but a lot of stuff we do will be around kind of request response, servers, web servers, things like that. So queues are great for anything that doesn't, you don't really need to process in the current response. Pass it off into the background and get to it later on. So a few examples, maybe you want to contact an external service, maybe you've got your Twitter feed down the side, you don't want to get that every time, run it in the background, things like that. And maybe you need to update a whole pile of stuff after you, maybe an order has gone through and there's a whole pile of tables that will be updated, but you don't need them right away. Add another incoming data sources, maybe you parse out, like an RSS feed or something like that, maybe that's kind of integral to what you're doing. But again, it's not part of what the kind of the request response stuff is, run that in the background. Or as where I first came across ZeroMQ was to do with kind of social updates. So if you think about one user maybe does something and you want to let them, all their pals know what happens, and that can kind of grow quickly. And the likes of, you know, big players and celebrities on there, maybe 10,000 accounts, it's going to take a long time to process that action, so you don't have done that all in the background somewhere. Basic terminology for queues, you've got a producer on one end, which makes a task or makes a message, and you've got a consumer on the other end, knows, understands it, does something with it, quite simple. And then quite often, you've got a thing in the middle, which is a broker, and what happens is pretty much the producer sends a message into the broker, and then at the other end, you've got consumer is reading off that broker. So in the database example, you save things moving in the table, and then you've got a cron job that just reads that table, pulls them out and processes them one by one. Things like RabbitMQ and other kind of dedicated message services will be a bit more intelligent about that and can be a bit more optimized for how it's working. But essentially you've got this big chunk in the middle that everything runs through. So for example, the whole database idea is one. Save tasks to the database, as I just said. Which for small to medium kind of size stuff, works pretty well. Definitely used that in the last place I was in for kind of processing some background events that were being fired off the monitoring system. So worked pretty well for that. However, it's obviously adding load to your DB, and if that's your kind of your front facing and you're kind of relying on your website to run off it, it's probably not great to be adding loads more load onto it, especially if you are going to pile this up loads of events. If that kind of starts happening, then you start running into problems of maybe the table locking up. For example, if you're writing to it all the time and trying to ping it every second or something to get off, chances are you might run into some blocks eventually because most databases are not optimized to do kind of write, read, and update all at the same time. They're kind of more optimized to kind of do one of those particularly well, usually. A few exceptions to that rule, obviously. So the next kind of best thing is something like RabbitMQ, ActiveMQ, IronMQ, can't remember, Amazon have their own kind of service that runs it. Google App Engine's got their own service that kind of do things. Those kind of services you don't need to worry about, they just happen. Again, as I said, they're much more sophisticated. They kind of run things asynchronously. You don't need to worry about the load being on your kind of your database. And again, they work great. I've used RabbitMQ as well myself. It's kind of default. default for a lot of the Python kind of, like Django's a plugin, well, it's not Django, sorry. It's a big package for Python called Celery. Robinhood is the kind of default for that, so use that. Runs beautifully, smoothly. Will eat all of your RAM if you let it, and kind of be a big beast in the middle. The guys get around to the kind of zero MQ stuff. The guys who wrote zero MQ, I think it's iMatrix, they actually were involved in the writing of the first protocol, which protocol essentially a lot of these big huge dedicated bits of software will run off. And the big thing that they kind of realized was you've asynchronously dumped all this data off in the background, but all you've done is kind of replaced it with this one big monolith in the middle. It's kind of your single point of failure. So that goes down, you're kind of kaput. And then what they realized is they spent loads of time trying to fix that and trying to make sure that things never failed in there. But obviously we know that things do from time to time. So what they did is they kind of went the other way and came up with zero MQ, which initially meant zero broker and zero latency. And those were the overriding factors in kind of designing what zero MQ is. So instead of having this broker in the middle, they're like, that's a bit of a bad design. We've got all these services talking to each other. We don't want this one big chunk in the middle that's going to let things fail. So we've got rid of the broker. And also then zero latency. So these guys, the background was high velocity data transfer in the financial sector. So obviously milliseconds plus billions. So everything had to be as fast as possible. Since kind of gone on to mean these things, but I've no idea what that really means. But they list it on the site. So where we're left then, zero MQ, zero brokers, zero latency. So how do things actually work? They've got this massive blurb on their website of zero MQ in 100 words. And to pick out a couple of things, because it can be a bit hard going to digest if you don't actually really understand it, so I'll run through it. So it's an embeddable network that acts like a concurrency library. So it's just a bit of software. It's literally a library. It's written in pretty much any language that you could imagine. Originally, the actual kind of guts of it were originally kind of put together in C++. But if you're writing it, if you're writing in any language, you'll find a library for it. The concurrency thing we'll maybe get to later on, but the next kind of thing that kind of is interesting in here is that sockets carry atomic messages. So I've not, but lots of people kind of talk about TCP programming, where whenever things get sent down in TCP, it gets sent as a stream, not as a string. So you need to figure out when that stream ends and when the next message starts and things like that. So what zero MQ does, it takes away that little bit of complexity and just says, right, here's a whole message. And what it'll guarantee is that you get that whole message or you don't get it all. It doesn't guarantee necessarily that the message will get to you, but it will guarantee that you get a full message. So you don't need to worry about partial bits of pieces coming through. Which is kind of handy. Various transports. So I've mentioned TCP will kind of run over, but it'll also run over, I can't remember any, IPC kind of in proc. So you can kind of have things running from maybe like one server to another server over TCP. You can have things running obviously within your own server, kind of keep things locked down a bit more. But the interesting stuff, which I've never got to, but it also is very interesting, is you can actually talk, two processes can kind of talk to each other, and also within the same threads. Get down to that sort of level. And that's where the kind of concurrency stuff comes in, that it's a big selling point that they kind of make within their guide. It's around, forget about doing threads, just do this, it's a lot more easy to kind of handle. You can connect pretty much anything to anything. So any number of sockets to any number of, or any number of receivers to producers. And everything's put together with patterns that we'll get to in a second. All fairly fast to go through this. Big thing, obviously, to keep the speed up and keep things as we want them to be with queues. Everything's asynchronous. And you're probably all just staring blankly now. So, make things a little bit clearer. Quick bit of code. So, here is a zero MQ server in what, 78 lines of code. So, first up, you've got a context, Which is just kind of pulling in the zero MQ library and giving it an instance to it. Apparently, main reason for doing this is if you've got another bit of your application which is also referencing it, the two won't kind of interfere with each other. Next bit up is, so you've now got your context and you can't get working. Next bit up is you're going to create a socket. And there's a couple of different socket types we'll move on to in a second, but this one is a reply socket through the socket rep. Rep reply, quite easy to understand. We're binding that to any available port on, or any available interface on 5555, which means that that's kind of locked down in that. Obviously, if there's something else on that port, it'll fail, so you can't maybe run on 80 if you're running a web server. And then what we're going to do is just infinitely loop, and whenever we get a message on this socket, which is the request, we just want to print it out. And then what we'll do is we'll just send a reply back. So reasonably simple. So we've got our context, our socket, we're going to connect our socket, actually make it live, and then we're just going to wait for messages to come in on that socket, which is that request bit, and then we're just going to send back a reply. So this is fairly rudimental and not very great service, but if we look at the other end, this is the ZMQ client. Same idea, we've got a context, we set a socket, this time it's a request socket rather than reply. Makes kind of sense if you're trying to set up a request reply kind of system. We connect this time instead of binding, so we don't want to have this connect permanently. We just want to kind of fire a message and then wait for a response. So we send the message, hello, and then we wait for the it'll block until it receives something back, and then it kind of prints out. So a few kind of, that's probably still a little bit, so we're kind of maybe quickly trying to show a quick demo of how that might work. So top one here is going to be a server, and we failed, awesome, because I'm running something else here. So that's our server up and running. So let's, down here we've got a slightly different version of what was there. It's just, it takes a couple of arguments. So what we're going to do here is we're going to say that we're going to send a message of PHP, and within this app, what I've done is just said every second, ping this message PHP. So as we can see, as expected, that's quite fun, which is kind of nothing particularly exciting to be honest. We all work at HTTP, this is kind of bread and butter stuff. If we kind of add in another thing, then what we find is, so we've kind of added one in every half a second. The ZMQ has the intelligence to figure out what's coming in, fairly queue it up. As you can see, it should be 2 for 1 within that system there. And that kind of just keep on going. Another kind of cool thing is that, say our server goes away. Well, okay, we're stopped here because we can't send any more messages because nothing's coming back. We kind of explicitly said block. But what's happened is if we can open that up again, we've had a few messages just kind of queued up there and it's kind of come back in again. So that's it. What will happen is that ZMQ itself will queue messages within its own, it runs things in a background thread for receiving the messages. So it can kind of handle kind of incoming stuff until it just for whenever. And you can kind of set that limit. So obviously you don't want it to be kind of sitting there doing nothing, you want to kind of feel fast and figure out what's wrong. But I think the default is something like 1,000 messages can come in before it decides, right, I can't handle any more, I'm going to just stop. So, and another interesting thing is that because it's network, or language agnostic, I've got a similar script here, just running in Python. And just to kind of give a bit of an example, I'm going to fire these pretty quickly. And as you can see, things still kind of happen. Those doesn't really care less. There's a couple of stats that I've not done, but different people have kind of done, and it's kind of something ludicrous, I can't remember the exact figure, but something like a million second messages a second over fairly standard hardware. So it's obviously that's not doing anything really processor intensive, but that's kind of what we're gonna make. All of you very confused. Any questions at this point? No. Okay. So, as I said, there's different socket types. So we saw there a reply, a request and reply, which obviously pair up pretty well together. We've got baked in a couple of other kind of types. So we've also got push-pull, which is pretty much fire and forget. So we don't want any response coming back. We just want to fire messages until whenever. The difference, the thing with this though, is there has to be something at the other end that will queue them up until it kind of gets through. But you just kind of, there's no response, it's just kind of fire. So it's great, as we'll see for a couple of different things there. It's got PubSub baked in, so you maybe you might have come across PubSub, things like Redis, things like that kind of do. You publish, and if anybody can listen, you're just publishing away. And if there's nobody there, oh well, the message goes nowhere, and you can kind of have, you know, multiple subscribers to this one kind of message going out. So example, maybe one example might be the Facebook thing, as I mentioned earlier, the network, social network. If you update something and you want to inform all your pals, that would be kind of like a pop up. So you kind of make one broadcast, they're all listening to you, and you get all the message. There's a couple of other things thrown in as well, which I've not had to deal with a lot. I kind of get into more where the speed stuff kind of comes in and the nuances of it. So we've got a router dealer and an X-sub and an X-pub, which are pretty much just an async way of doing the previous ones, even more async way of doing it. Zero MQ, whenever it's sending stuff, it said that it sends a string, but it also has a little kind of bit of frame at the beginning of the message, like an envelope, so you can send like envelopes. Things like the router and the X-sub and X-pub kind of take advantage of that, so they don't even look at, they don't care what the message is. They kind of see the envelope and they can like pass it on to somebody else, which again helps with the speed side of stuff. Stuff that I've not really got into. And then there's also just kind of like an exclusive pair option as well. So with those kind of basic types, the whole thing with ZeroMQ is building up patterns. So we'll go through the kind of very basic ones. So we've already seen the request reply, which is just kind of what's running. Dead simple, we all know that. You ask for something, you get something back. This is the push-pull one, kind of, and this is kind of more of the stuff that it might be used for. So you get, maybe say, a user uploads an image that you want to process, and its processing can be quite costly. So what you might want to do is start firing this off to a little bit different workers to kind of handle that processing. So something like the push-pull would be really handy for that, because you don't really care what's coming back, you just want to process that image. So something like this, you would have the ventilator, would just be like, for example, something making a job. You then push it out to these three workers, which again, ZeroQ kind of fairly routes those across the workers, so you can kind of task things out. All the jobs get done, and then eventually they kind of end up somewhere. Job's done, or maybe you pass that off to something else. And again, as I said, pops up stuff, so you've got one person kind of throwing out, a lot of people listening to that, so multiple people listening. Big thing about it is that the publisher itself doesn't really care if there's anybody listening or not. So those messages would get chucked away, they'd go to nobody. There's no guarantee that anybody's even listening. So the exclusive pair, I'm not entirely sure what that is because I've never had a look at that. ZeroMQ said it's all about kind of mess these patterns. And if you have a look on their website, it has there's a thing called ZeroMQ the Guide, which is I've got about halfway through it. It's pretty huge, it's actually quite a big thick book, I ended up buying it in the end. Quite interesting to read, if nothing else. Great kind of, the guy who wrote it, it's quite an interesting sort of guy. But they go heavily into the multiple different types of patterns. With these three or four like kind of basics, you can then build up into kind of like a quite an expansive fallback kind of options, caching bits and pieces, maybe proxies, things like that. And they've kind of got stacks of it, and that's where the kind of really interesting stuff kind of comes in. To say that I've kind of half-heartedly been doing, trying to finish this off, not half-heartedly, just trying to quickly, new job and all that, but quick demo, what I had wanted to build was something that kind of took in a load of these different options. What is there is very, very basic, but we'll get to it. So where I came across ZeroQ was a little startup and was an interactive app, so it's Skype with loads of actions going on inside of it. And everything kind of interacted with an API, as you would imagine. But the API was only one side of things. We also had an XMPP server that kind of dealt with some real-time stuff. We were on iOS with notifications firing off whenever things happened for iOS. Android was coming in the pipeline, things like that. So we wanted something that could kind of hook all these things up. So the basic demo that I was kind of going to try and show you, and hopefully it's the very bare bones of this, is going to work, is we've got an API that just our usual website we can kind of fire things back and forward to. It could be a website, could be an app, could be whatever. It takes those and then it'll fire off, do various bits and pieces, and then it's got a notification system, so it's a web app, this one, so best place for notifications would be a WebSocket. We're going to have a WebSocket that's kind of listening for stuff, messages coming in. If, with any luck, this will make more sense as I show it to you. If I pull up. So, very kind of simple. Slim up, so this is our API. All we have is our homepage, because we're on a homepage. This is our API here, which takes a message on this sprout. What it does with the message then is it's going to send this message using the 0MQ socket and push. So what we're going to do is we're just going to push this message out. We're going to push it out because we don't really care that much if it gets delivered. It's kind of a minor thing. So we're not going to wait for a reply or anything. We want things to happen pretty quickly. So we're just going to send things off from our service to say, notification, this has just happened. So in the real kind of day, this will be doing loads of stuff, maybe in terms of the request. And then there'll be other bits and pieces going off in the background, and then we're sending this notification off to our little service that's going to be running. So this is just a very simple little script that's kind of going to be running in the background, maybe using something like Upstart to kind of keep it running forever. And what you can see here is we've got two different sockets connected here. So we're going to connect, first of all, the pull, which is going to receive in from our API. It's going to receive a notification. And then we've also got this publish socket. So we're going to receive a notification. We want to notify people that something's happened. So what it's going to do is receive that and then just publish it to whoever's listening. So whoever's listening could be the web app, in our case it will be, it could be any number of other services. Maybe it's another part of the application that needs to do something with it. Whatever. And then last but not least, as some lovely horrible node code to handle the WebSocket. So all we're going to do here is we're going to set up a very basic WebSocket just using Socket.io because it's easy. And then whenever we're going to connect here with the connect on. And then within that, we're going to wait for messages to come in we're going to be listening for messages that are published through the subscriber. And then what we're going to do is take that message and fire it back down the WebSocket. So it's just a notification that something's happened. So in a real world scenario, this could be, again, your Facebook or Twitter. Oh, somebody's just updated something. Here's their link to their feed. Could be any number of things in reality. So if we start everything up, this is where things fall down. Refresh. I broke it just 2 minutes before we started, but we're going to send this one text feed is going to send off to our API, and then things are going to happen. And we've got a little bit underneath that's going to be listening for incoming messages. So Socket.io, the web socket, is just going to, it's supposed to fire out a message. I've obviously done something somewhere, and it's not giving me the right message. Not a very interesting thing, but what's happening there is it's kind of doing a whole round trip in the background. And the next bit, which is totally untested, is if I try to make use of yeah. Yeah, it breaks. I'm not quite sure. There's probably something in the node that isn't working. That is supposed to go out in production. That's clearly broken. As I said, apologies, I've not spent enough time on that. The next kind of bit was actually supposed to be added in there was, for example, going off to a service, getting something, and then pushing that. So a real kind of use case of, say, for example, you need to get a load of data from a load of different services. You don't want to be sitting there waiting for that request. So you'd open up a WebSocket or a pool, some sort of socket. In this case, you'd send out, do all the wording. Maybe you're kind of filling in for 100 different websites, processing it, and then sending back a response. That's what was supposed to happen. With lovely gifts and things, but it didn't. Apologies. So that's a very, very quick, brief introduction to ZeroMQ. I've probably not done it anywhere near enough justice. Seriously, go away, read about it. Very interesting. You might never get a chance to use it, but it's fascinating sort of stuff. And Q's well in handy in the future. That's it. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Any questions?
I'm not like overly familiar with Q systems, I guess, but what would be the advantage of something like this over, say, like pusher.com or like just standard web sockets for doing things like that? There is it's a similar sort of thing. I take it there's more to it because you can probably handle with it being different languages, different systems can interact with each other maybe a bit more than something like Pusher can.
Yeah, I don't know Pusher myself. But I can't take a wild guess at what it does.
Yeah.
So the big advantage is, so for example, the WebSocket stuff, everything would need to be happening within that application. So this the whole kind of premise, I guess, is kind of this, is it's along the same movement of web services as opposed to having a big monolith. Mm. So you kind of spread things out from the desk.
More distributed. It's more distributed.
Yeah, that's the idea. So there's that kind of side of things, and it depends what you want to use it for. So for example, you could quite easily hook something up, and you've got some legacy, massive big code base that's sitting somewhere you don't want to touch, but you need to interact with it. You could quite quickly set up a ZeroMQ server within that
to talk to it
and kind of fire stuff back and forward. Yeah. It's quite an easy way, quite a nice way to kind of cook kind of do things up. So said the guys that wrote it talk a lot about building software and building simple software. So the whole premise of this is kind of building small, simple to understand components. You might be able to get to one person to kind of manage the whole kind of thing. So that's kind of one of the benefits. Obviously, that comes with some downsides as well. We don't have all these services to manage as opposed to do one kind of site or whatever. Anybody else?
Just can you send something off to the queue and tell it to process at a certain date or time?
So this is where the bare bones aspect of ZeroMQ would come in. So they would not have that baked in, but you would have to write that yourself. So you'd need to maybe store it somewhere to then process at a later point. So there's definitely done some reading. People will be using very fast kind of in-memory databases to kind of sort of store stuff very quick, or embedded databases and things for kind of storing those bits and blobs, the things that you might want to process later. But yeah, definitely, it's not baked in, but you just have to build it yourself. Same as kind of the big one people kind of fall down on is that things like your database and your RabbitMQ would kind of don't have 100% guarantees that your data's not going to get lost, but they've definitely got a fair chunk of, a lot of their effort's gone into, especially in terms of the dedicated queues, a lot of their effort has gone into trying to make those feel safe, that they will not break and your data won't disappear. This kind of stuff, you have to build by yourself. As I said, the whole point being making it fast and without these kind of single points of failure. So you then distribute around many servers, maybe only handles that's information that's coming into it, but doesn't handle stuff going to somewhere else. So,
thank you.
Roger.
Your example there with the request for value, we're basically having one producer and one worker working through that, but presumably multiple workers, and is there any sort of a rule of thumb as to how many workers is an optimal? Or?
I think the same as trying to figure out how many workers you need in any kind of queuing system, it's about what your load's coming in, and being able to kind of figure that out yourself, pretty much, and trying to be able to scale that as it increases or decreases. In terms of how it's processed, that's where some of the kind of those couple of sockets I didn't really talk about, the router dealer, would come in so you can quite easily fan that out to just examples of finding this out to your server farms if you have sites, the kind of information being processed. So, and again, everything you might still have one or two little points of failure within that side of things, that one kind of process. But again, those things are doing so little, they're literally just passing messages and kind of running them. And that, you know, as any kind of proxy would do, they're not interacting in any way with the data itself. So that can happen so quickly that it doesn't really matter in some ways, and do so little that the chances of them failing are reduced. Yeah, you can definitely scale those up and down as much as you like. Seriously, if you are interested at all, look on ZeroMQ, Google ZeroMQ, the guide, and you'll find this monster book that will give you loads of different kind of patterns about kind of trying to make things feel safe, trying to, you know, how best to kind of expand things out and all the rest of it. Yeah.
Is it equally good for running really big tests? Like I say, I upload a video and I want to transcode that video. That's obviously a much longer running task.
Yep. So again, it doesn't really care. And again, this is one thing I've never really thought about before. It again guarantees that transport. So it doesn't care if it's a 1 byte message coming through or a 10 gigabyte message coming through. It'll arrive in one chunk and it'll guarantee it all arrives or it doesn't. And again, what processing is going on the other end is just that processing. So it doesn't really care. Cool. Cheers. Thanks very much.